Hello, welcome to Global Science webinar about the relevance of PKI and digital signing in 2020. Thank you all for joining us today. My name is Megan Brower and I would like to introduce you to our host, Christoph Marin. Christoph is the Customer Success Program Manager. I would now like to hand it over to Christoph.
Hello everyone, thank you Megan for the introduction. My name is Christoph and I'll be giving you a little bit more information and insights on the relevance of PKI and one specific use case, digital signing. First of all, an overview on what we are going to be covering today. To begin with, we are going to look at the modern day cybersecurity threats that an average CISO has to deal with. Then we're going to cover what PKI is, what it does, and how it contributes to solving these threats. And lastly, we're going to zoom in on one specific use case, which is digital signing. So to begin with, cybersecurity threats today, I've listed up a few examples of threats that generally every CISO or security expert has to deal with inside his organization or her organization, of course. Security for mobile devices is one of them. It's important to make sure that all of these mobile devices don't become vulnerabilities. Phishing is very common and very much in the rise. Forged documents are also something quite common, and then there's many other things to deal with. Now, how do you deal with all of these vulnerabilities? That is a very big question to which we could do a lot of webinars or PowerPoint presentation. So there are quite a few threats. What we will be focusing on today are a few of those threats that can be solved by PKI and PKI solutions. As most security experts probably know, most of the users of their systems, of their secure systems, are often very lazy. Everyone knows that person inside their organization who nicely puts all of his passwords on a sheet of paper and then probably leaves it on his desk whenever he leaves. Besides that, there's always people inside an organization who don't want to use the default Windows computers and who absolutely need to be able to work on a Mac device, or a lot of users who do most of or who want to have constant access to, for example, their emails and the backend, so need all of these connections on their own mobile device. Lastly, passwords are generally unreliable, not because of the fact that passwords are being used, but because of the specific passwords themselves. Very often we see people using 12345 password or just QWERTY as a password, which is of course very, very insecure. Now you can find a way to counter that by, for example, setting passwords requirements, but you'll still find that people will try a very easy and memorable way to generate a password, or even worse, as I indicated earlier, write it down. All of these things can be solved by stronger authentication, and that's where public key infrastructure or PKI comes into place. PKI is a proven concept with a lot of use cases. It can be used for network and service security. We're usually talking about SSL certificates in that case. A very common use case is also document signing. You can digitally sign almost anything, going from a PDF, an office document, so also PowerPoint, Excel, etc. Piece of software, and even emails can be digitally signed by PKI solutions. Besides that, there's encryption solutions like email encryption, and of course, authentication, like, for example, client authentication, where you want to restrict access to certain applications or environments with the use of a certificate. How PKI is being used depends on the key usage. There are different types of key usage that will eventually determine what your certificate is being used for, and whether it's for network and server security, or for example, for digital signatures. A certificate can also contain certain information that will be linked to the real world. This information can go from individual personal names, for example, to departments over entire organizations. So apply to digital signatures, for example, that you can sign in your own name, you can sign in the name of a department, you can sign in the name of an organization or any combination, for example, signed by Christoph Marin from Global Sign. A bit more insight on how PKI actually works. This specific use case is for encryption, because that's the easiest way to explain it, and I don't want to dive too deep into technical details. But here in this example, Alice wants to share a secret or confidential information with Bob. Now, first of all, Bob will need a digital certificate. This digital certificate can be purchased through a certificate authority, for example, like GlobalSign. Once Bob has a certificate, this certificate will consist of a private and a public key. It's important that Bob obviously keeps the private key private under his sole possession, and Alice distributes the public key to whoever is he wants to have encrypted communication with. This can be done in various ways and is often facilitated by the applications. For example, if we're talking about email signing, then very often it's or email encryption, and it's facilitated by clients like Outlook. So once Alice has Bob's public key to his certificate, she can use that public key to encrypt the message. This is done in a complex technical way, which I will not zoom into today. But once she has encrypted this message, the message becomes unreadable for anyone in the world, except for the owner of Bob's private key. So in short, whatever message is encrypted by Bob's public key can only be decrypted by Bob's private key. And that's basically how it works. Once the message is encrypted, she can send it. No one can read it, except, of course, Bob with his private key, who will be able to decrypt it and receive the message. Now, before a certificate authority like GlobalSign issues this certificate to Bob, we will, of course, check the identity. Basically, that means that Bob will have to request a certificate to GlobalSign, and GlobalSign will then verify all the information in the certificate, identity information of the individual, of the organization, if necessary, even of the department. We will verify that. That's our RA department, to make sure that Bob is really who he claims to be, and that no one can just request a certificate for anyone's name. After the checks are done, our CA, which is also a part of our company, will issue a digital certificate which includes the identity information. So the certificate will say, this is Bob, this is Bob's certificate. And that certificate, of course, as I indicated, consists of a private and public key. If you want to know more about it, you can always look up some information on PKI or on asymmetric cryptography, which is what this is all based on. That's a bit of technical background on certificates, but looking at it from a more abstract point of view, what are digital certificates? Well, in short, the digital certificate is just a way to provide to prove your identity online. So a digital passport, just like in the real world, you show your passport to prove who you are, and then whoever is requesting your passport, for example, the police at the airport, will trust the information that is written on your passport, of course, assuming it's a real passport and not a fake one. With PKI, it's kind of the same, but based on cryptography. So let's zoom in on that part in the next few slides. To make the comparison a bit better, you can see that I've found a real ID, which is on the left side, and on the right side you can find a digital ID or a certificate. As you can see, both are issued by a trusted instance. In this case, on the left side, that is the Australian government, which is allowed to generate passports that are valid in an international context. If someone has an Australian passport, then it is recognized outside of Australia as well, for example, in the EU. with a digital certificate, that issuer also has to be a trusted instance, like, for example, GlobalSign. Any passport will have a valid from and valid to date or an expiration date. And that's also the case here in both cases. So you can see that the Australian passport, it's actually already expired. But the same applies for the certificate, which also has a starting and an end date. So it can't be valid indefinitely for security purposes. It contains a name, Citizen Jane here. Same with the certificate. It will always have a subject or a common name. Now, depending on the type of certificate, this can be different. What you can see on the slide here in subject is internal.internal.globalsign.com, which is a domain name. This can be a domain name, but it can also be a personal name if you're, for example, digitally signing a document. It will also have a document number. That's the same for a certificate, which will contain a serial number. The comparison even goes further because of the instance who issued it. And you can actually see that it's very, very similar. Now, initially you get a passport, and this passport was issued by a local passport office, town hall, for example, or a police station, whoever does that within the country that you request a passport in. Now, this passport office is not recognized by abroad countries. So you cannot request an Australian passport in Belgium, for example. These are locally trusted. However, the document that is generated holds its value still in an international context because the government is universally trusted. In the EU, we know that if someone comes with an Australian passport, that this passport will be trusted in the end, and that we trust the Australian government to issue valid passports and to make sure that the information in there is actually reliable. And that all happens even though we don't know specifically from which office in Australia it was generated. The same applies to certificates. So you have a digital certificate. Initially, this is untrusted. Anyone can make a digital certificate, but because it's issued, generated by a trusted third party, a CA like GlobalSign, it will be recognized as a valid signature. The use case that I want to zoom in on is digital signing, especially these days with everyone working from home or a lot of people working from home. This becomes more and more relevant. A lot of people don't have printers at home, which means that the old process of printing, signing, scanning, and sending is not really easy to achieve at home. And a lot of companies are looking for alternative solution. These alternative solutions can be electronic signatures. First of all, I'm going to cover a little bit of terminology to make sure that everyone understands what a electronic signature is and how it compares to a digital signature. That is because electronic signatures are kind of an umbrella term. There are different levels of trust, and some of them have actual legal value, whereas others don't. I've created a quick overview with the most important distinction. When talking about electronic signatures in general, that's not really a standardized term. So there are a lot of possibilities, and there's not just a way to do it. With an electronic signature, when we're talking about electronic signature, it doesn't guarantee that whoever signs with the electronic signature is verified, is actually who he claims to be by a third party. So making the comparison with the digital passport, we would not, or this electronic signature placed by a digital passport would not guarantee that this person is who he claims to be, hence limiting the value of the signature, of course. And basically, an electronic signature can be anything. It can be the initials, it can be an image of that person, it can be an image of his actual paper signature, or it can even just be a tick box. So the terminology is not standardized and the legal value therefore is very limited because you can't really prove who's behind a basic electronic signature. If you want to add legal value to your signatures, then you will likely need to go for digital signatures. Digital signatures are always based on cryptographic technology, so PKI, as we covered before, and will always have a identity that is verified by a third party. So whatever you have in your certificate, which you use to place digital signatures, it will be checked upfront before you get that certificate. So you can't just obtain a digital certificate in the name of the Pope or Bill Gates, of course. The signature is also tied to a cryptographic operation. Not going to zoom in too hard on that one, but basically it means that you can't change the document afterwards, after it is signed, because that will corrupt the signature. A very simple example. The first one, or the top one, is an example of a electronic signature. As you can see, it is signed by the Pope. This has zero value. Why? Because I created this. You can just look up online the signature of basically any famous person, President of the United States, the Pope, Bill Gates, and download an image of that, and then you can paste that under any document and claim whatever you want. This has no legal value because the signature was not verified. The document could have been tampered with after the signature was placed, and there's no indication whatsoever of when it was signed. We could even mention a date there, but again, I could mention the date of 10 years ago, even though I made these slides a few weeks ago. If you compare it to a digital signature, which here I opened in Adobe Reader, then you can see that the identity of the signer is verified. You can check that in the signature panel. If you have a signed document yourself and you open that via any Adobe Reader application, it will automatically verify the validity of the signature for you and show you if it's valid or not. The integrity of the document is also guaranteed. This comes back to the hashing that I covered a minute or two ago. But if you have a signature and it shows with a valid signed and all signatures valid field, as you can see in the print screen, then that means that the document has not changed. If you change the slightest thing, the slightest letter on the document, the signature will become corrupt and you will not have a signed document. So hence, a valid signature guarantees that the document hasn't been changed. And lastly, there is a timestamp added from a calibrated clock. Why is this important? Again, if you can't prove why when a document was signed, then that tremendously limits the value of the signature. Another difference, or another important reason to use digital signatures, is because they meet the requirement of a lot of regulations. Internationally, there are a lot of valid, a lot of applying e-signature regulations inside of the European Union. It's relatively simple because, or relatively standardized, is maybe better, because of eIDAS. But most of these regulations come down to the following five principles. The signature or the certificate has to be unique to the signer and is to be capable of identifying the signer. Now, this first part, or the first two parts, global sign covers by a verification that we do when we issue a certificate. So we always validate all the information inside a certificate, and we have quite complex sometimes processes to ensure that whenever we issue a certificate, we know 100% sure that whoever is in the certificate actually requested it. Besides that, it's important that the certificate is under the sole possession of the signer. So I can have a signature in my name, but or a certificate in my name, but if everyone can use that, then again, the value of my signature is practically non-existent. So it's important to make sure that only you can use it. Practically, that means that you need to protect your private key of your certificate. This typically happens through hardware. From a technical point of view, you could install a certificate on your laptop, for example, but this is restricted by certificate authorities, of course, working together with Adobe, who sets out the general guidelines for PDF signing. And the way that we protect this private key is usually on a USB token or a smart card. You can install a certificate on there. This cryptographic USB token or smart card will protect that private key, but allows you to use it whenever you need. It will be impossible to extract the private key from the token or the smart card. It remains on there. Besides this possession requirement, it's also important, and I covered this again a few minutes ago, that the data can't change. That's why we do the cryptographic hash check. And of course, that we can determine the time, which is done by a third-party timestamp confirming the time and date at which the document was signed, of course. A last thing to cover is the importance of public trust. The easiest comparison to make there is to make the comparison with the passport authority. Basically, a passport, anyone can make a document that says passport and that includes whatever name that you want it to be. And the same applies for certificate. It's not a closed technology. Everyone can make a certificate relatively easy if you have the right knowledge. But that doesn't mean that it's actually recognized. Just like a paper saying passport and confirming your name as being Bill Gates, for example, doesn't have any value. An untrusted signature doesn't have one either, which means that in order to place valid signatures, you'll need to go to a certificate authority to get that certificate. Otherwise, it's relatively useless in almost any use case. For documents, well, if you're talking about PDF, then all it comes down to is you want to be trusted by Adobe. For that, you need to be on the Adobe Authorized Trust List, AATL. So that's the type of certificates that you'll need to look out for if you want to digitally sign PDF documents. For Microsoft, so we're talking about Office documents, you need to be in the Microsoft Root Trust List. But again, if you're just signing PDFs, then that's not very relevant. The last part of this webinar, I've covered the advantages of digital signatures, very basically how it works as well. But given that everyone's working from home, or a lot of people are at the moment, why is not everyone using it at the moment? What is actually stopping people from using digital signatures everywhere? Because I've covered that it's also more secure than a paper signature. You can't change it afterwards. It confirms the time. You can't just copy it if you can copy handwriting, for example. So why isn't everyone using this? Well, there are a few barriers still in the market. What I want to do is go over them and then see which ones we can perhaps solve for you. I would say that the biggest barrier is probably the lack of knowledge in the market. There is a lot of confusion over which type of signature you need from a technical point of view, but more important from a legal point of view. You have all of these different regulations, and even though generally they say the same things, you want to make sure that you actually comply with these regulations that are relevant to you. So there's a lot of confusion about that. And very often in the legal department, there's not always the technical knowledge or technical understanding of digital signatures to be able to make a decision there. Of course, there's hardware, as I mentioned, to protect the private key. Cryptographic hardware is generally quite expensive, even though the USB tokens nowadays are relatively cheap. And then there is custom development. If you make a solution and you're not using the plug and play Adobe USB tokens on Adobe Reader, then you will need to do development work to actually integrate that into your existing workflows. And that also means that you will need some kind of cryptographic expertise. Now, not a lot of people have cryptographic expertise, and the ones that do generally tend to cost your company quite a lot of money. So this can be a budgetary barrier with regards to adopting digital signatures. I've covered briefly that, of course, that you need to protect your private key. I just want to zoom in on the different types that allow you to protect your private key, I've covered the USB tokens. Smart cards are basically the same, but there is an alternative. You can also buy an HSM, which is some kind of hardware appliance that you can connect to your network where that hosts your certificates. This makes things a lot more complicated and certainly a lot more expensive, but allows you to work in cloud environments with digital signatures. An HSM is a difficult investment because of the price, easily 30,000 euros, and of course, including maintenance. And on the other hand, the knowledge that you need to have, which is also very expensive. To kind of cover between the gap between the kind of plug and play USB tokens in most use cases and the very complex and expensive HSMs, there are cloud solutions. So you can actually rent a part of an HSM online and host your certificates there. That can generally be the best solution if you're on the one hand looking for cloud environments and on the other hand don't want costs to explode. GlobalSign went a bit further in that, by the way. We made a full API-based service where we actually host the certificates and even generate them for you as you sign. So with regard to that, there are a few advantages. But generally, the market is evolving towards more cloud-based solutions and more digitalization of the entire process. People don't want to use USB tokens generally. So and also don't want to have all of the expertise with regards to IT in-house because it's too expensive. So most of the use cases, people go for a cloud solution with regards to digital signing. Well, this has a few advantages because there is no hardware that you need to invest in. This is all managed by whoever hosts your HSM for you. And the on-premise footprint will also be very limited or even zero in some use cases. You will not need to do custom development work because it's all API based. So you just need to connect the API to the API. And there is no need for cryptographic expertise. I've had quite a few projects over the years where I've worked with people who never even touched the subject of PKI and who still managed to get a solution or a cloud digital signing solution up and running inside their organizations. I think that was it for today. I hope I was able to teach you something new with regards to PKI and more specific digital signatures. I would say, should you have any questions, feel free to reach out to GlobalSign or to me personally. I'd be glad to answer any of them. For the rest, I hope you have a wonderful day.